We are calling the special meeting of the City Council to order for Monday, March 20th, 5 p.m. Roll call, please.
Councilmember Kusumoto?
Here.
Councilmember Murphy?
Here.
Councilmember Wilson?
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem Edgar?
Here.
Mayor Hasselbrink?
Here. And this time, we're going to open it up for public comments for this agenda item only. The regular meeting at 6 o'clock will have another public comment, so is there anybody that would like to speak? You can speak from there, you're good.
Thank you. I'm Stefan Hammond, former member of the suspended cable TV commission. On slide number 9, you have an entry for the budget for cable TV. I'd like you to explain to the public what that's all about. It doesn't seem to have anything to do with any numbers having to do with the LATV.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. And seeing nobody else, we'll go ahead and close public comment and turn it over to Brett.
I'll start it. Over. Thank you, Mayor and City Council. This is another step in the budget process for fiscal year 2017-2018, and tonight we're going to start our first set of department overviews of the budget and go into some level of detail for the administration department, including my department, city clerk, and administrative services, and recreation and cultural arts. And with that intro, I will give it over to Jason Alamo, the administrative services director, to start the presentation.
So good evening, Mayor and members of the council. Before I start with the presentation, I wanted to kind of refresh and recap. A month ago, we actually had our first budget workshop for fiscal year 2017-18. And at the meeting last month, we discussed the preliminary proposed budget for fiscal year 17-18, which included a projected deficit of $274,000. And there were really two recommended gap closure items that were outlined in that report. One included a temporary freeze on open vacant positions citywide, primarily full-time but also part-time, and then also bringing an item back to the council related to a fees and charges study. We recently completed the fee study and plan to bring that item back to the council in May for consideration on recovering cost recoveries. So administration consists of city manager's office, the city clerk, and administrative services. This first slide is just kind of an overview of all the departments that report to the city manager and then up through the city council. I wanted to point out that we have 54 full-time employees citywide. Six of those 54 positions are currently vacant. And so as part of the budget gap closure, we are looking at each of those vacant positions. And during this kind of budget process, the department overviews, we are analyzing the impact on keeping those positions vacant. And in order to determine whether or not there is an impact on city services. The goal of each department is to continue to provide the same level of service even with those vacancies. And so what has been reflected in the recreation budget presentation will include two vacant positions, and in development services and police, they also have a total of four vacant positions, three in development services and one in police. Those two departments will actually be coming forward to the council next month at 5 o'clock at the council meeting in April, and we'll be providing an overview of their department's budget along with the impact of vacancies on their department. So the organizational structure of administrative services includes, like I said, city manager's office, which includes two full-time employees, Brett Plumley and Chelsea Wilson. City clerk's office includes the city clerk, Wendy, and one part-time employee. And then, of course, my department, which includes three full-time employees. That includes myself. And then there's three part-time staff. The one part-time employee is Maribel Palmer. She is an accounting manager, and she works about 15 to 20 hours per week. And then there's two other part-timers that really share duties. They provide front desk help to the front counter when people walk into City Hall. Just kind of an organizational structure, and put a picture of a face to each name as if you didn't know us already. So as you know, the City Council, the City Council's goal or mission is to set policy and fiscal policy, and then it's the city manager's responsibility to carry out those policies. The budget for the City Council includes the items that are listed on this page and reflects basically a budget that is relatively flat year over year. I wanted to point out that there's a small increase to the commissioner appreciation amount that's been budgeted, but other than that, year over year, the amounts are relatively flat. The City Council dues budget is $20,000, and the breakdown of those dues is listed on this slide as well. It's pretty much the same list of organizations that the city is a member of and has been a member of for a number of years. And so we're anticipating continuing that membership, and therefore those budgeted amounts have been reflected in the 17-18 budget. So the city manager's office, like I said, is responsible for implementation and execution of the overall management of each department. The city manager's budget also reflects the city clerk's budget. And I wanted to highlight a couple of things. First, the net increase year over year is about a $14,000 net increase, but there's a couple of items that I wanted to point out and bring to your attention. First of all, election expense. We had an election in 16-17, and the projected costs were about $14,000. And of course, we don't have an election in 17-18, and so we have remove that line item from the budget. So there's budgetary savings in 17-18. But then, as we know, pension costs are going up in 17-18. And so the impact on retirement expense in the city manager's budget is a $10,500 increase. And then there is an increase to salaries in the amount of approximately $15,000. And so therefore, the net impact ends up resulting in approximately a $14,000 net increase. I also wanted to add that the line item related to cable television, there is a contract with Arlo Sal that provides cable television services, which is basically management oversight of the cable function. It includes the filming of city council meetings that's done tonight and every night. It includes the programming and broadcasting of the footage that you see on Los Al television. And the cost of that function is partly allocated to the city manager's budget. These goals are goals that are provided here and for your feedback and review and consideration by the city manager. You know, the goals really impact and trickle down to each department. So for example, the financial goals will be carried out by my department. You know, there's goals that relate to infrastructure. Those will be carried out largely by development services. Personnel, you know, administrative goals, once again, would fall under administrative services. And, but just wanted to highlight a couple of those. The city clerk, I wanted to point out, as we all know, the city clerk supports the city council, but the city clerk also supports staff, administers elections, and manages city records. On this slide is a page or a list of a couple of goals, and I wanted to highlight a couple. First, the city clerk is also responsible for the coordination with department secretaries citywide, and she's taken on that responsibility recently. She's also responsible for managing public and internal inquiries, for ensuring compliance with federal, state, and local statutes, administering ethics training, and so on. And that's all on top of the things that you kind of see, you know, in terms of agenda preparation and that sort of thing. So administrative services, that's my department. And, you know, the mission, like it says here, is to continue to provide excellent service to both internal and external customers, and also maintaining a high level of accuracy, accountability, and timeliness. So my department, you know, consists of, you know, kind of a financial aspect or a financial division, also risk management, accounting, personnel, also information technology falls under my department, along with cable operations as well. Really anything administrative in nature that doesn't fit neatly within another department would most likely fall under administrative services. So the overall increase to administrative services is approximately a $13,300 increase year over year. I wanted to highlight a couple of things on this page. Contractual services are actually down year over year by approximately $10,000. In 16-17, we talked about last month how the 16-17 projected amount is projecting revenues to come in higher than originally budgeted. And part of that has to do with one-time revenues related to sales tax recoveries that have come in. And that was was the result of work done by our consultants, our sales tax consultants. And they received a 15% recovery fee as part of the contractual relationship that we have with them. And so therefore the cost of that is reflected in contractual services in 16-17. Of course, it's not going to be part, we don't expect it to be part of the baseline budget since there's no revenues in 17-18 relating to that one-time true-up. There's no expense associated with it as well. I also wanted to point out that salaries are actually projected to go up approximately $20,000. But that is really because in 16-17, we had a vacancy in that part-time classification for the accounting manager. The accounting manager that we hired in January of 2016, she left in the summer and still hung on with us a couple of hours a month until we found a replacement, actually just a couple months ago, or in January of 2017. But because there was a lapse in hours and coverage, we were able to realize significant savings in 16-17. But of course, our budgeting for that that part-time position in 17-18, and just as a kind of a background, we created that part-time position a couple years ago, really at the request of an audit issue that we dealt with, mm-hmm. which had to do with lack of segregation of duties. And so this part-time position allows us to properly segregate accounting controls and ensure that we have proper controls in place to deter and prevent fraud. A couple of my goals include, you know, overseeing the preparation of the financial statements. Also wanted to highlight that we're looking at potentially using reserves to pay down a portion of the city's unfunded pension liability. We're just exploring different ways that we may be able to use the $3.4 million of general fund reserves that's been set aside for pensions, and exploring if we did use, let's say, $1.2 million of that, what would the payback, what would the multiplier be in terms of pension savings over the long term? And so we're working with an actuary right now, and and in terms of identifying and exploring those cost savings. This is just the Personnel Appeals Commission. You know, knock on wood, we haven't met in a number of years, but it's, you know, they serve an important function of the city, and we appreciate their service to the city. So with that, I think that really wraps up my piece of the overview. Before I hand it over to Corey, do you have any questions that I might be able to answer?
Nice job.
Good job.
It's a cool looking park.
Cool looking event.
Yeah.
Good evening, Mayor, members of the council. Thank you so much. I'm going to speak about the Recreation and Community Services Department. First of all, thank you for attending this weekend. If you still want to see any of the artwork, we left a couple pieces up. The big graffiti art is right when you walk into the building. And the make your own art, make your mark on Weekend of the Art. We transfer that out into our lobby. So there's still a couple cool pieces that are out this week. Excuse me. So just to kind of go over our budget, 16-17, our projected expenditures is about $1.71 million in revenues, about a little over almost $1.1 million. For 17-18, our preliminary budget is about $1.8 million. With basically an equivalent revenue budget. However, keep in mind that is fully staffed, and currently we're sitting at two vacancies in our full-time authorized staff. So we're authorized right now at seven, but we do have two vacancies that we're realizing in 16-17, and then we'll be part of the budget process going forward to help with some of the offsets. And then we run 30 to 60 part-time staff throughout the year. Obviously, our heavy time during the summertime, we're closer to the 60 mark. The wintertime, we're holding on to 30. But again, realizing that some staff get as few as a couple hours a week, some as much as 20 to 25 a week. This table shows our staffing over the last several years. In 14-15 was actually our highest year for our FTEs. We had about 20.1 full-time positions. In 15-16, when we created the recreation coordinator positions, we realized some savings from one retirement and the coordinators coming on not right at the beginning of the fiscal year, as well as some vacancies in our part-time positions. We also basically retired several of our coordinator, or all of our part-time coordinator positions, to move them into the full-time coordinator positions. But the actual FTEs that we realized in 15-16 was about 18. Right now for 17-18, we're anticipating about 15.46 FTEs. One thing to keep in mind also for this is obviously our department is very, very part-time staff heavy. They, you know, are the frontline staff dealing with our day camp that is a 10-to-1 ratio, our swim lessons that are 3-to-1, 6-to-1, or 8-to-1, and then our park programs. We have two staff at each location with up to 60, sometimes even 80 kids at the location. So a lot of our staff that are on site. The community center, the hours listed are 7:30 to 5:30, but we do have programming that runs till 8, 9, 10 o'clock at night. So we have part-time staff that are at the front desk, as well as we have one department secretary who works 40 hours a week, but our building is technically open about 50 hours a week. So we do have part-time staff that fill in the gap, as well as you go to any, excuse me, any of our special events, you'll see they do a lot of the heavy lifting. The again, this kind of shows what our seven full-time staff are. I operate as the director. Emmeline and Ron as our recreation managers. And Megan Shimada is our coordinator. We do currently have a vacant coordinator. Trini is our department secretary, and then the full-time secretary position is vacant. This just kind of goes over, and I apologize for the small printing, but wanted to give you a good visual of the duties and how it's divvied up. Due to the vacancy in the secretary as well as in the coordinator, this has changed several times. But just to draw your attention again, these five positions are the only five full-time positions. The rest of these are part-time. They're just our lead staff. Anna's our receptionist. You'll see her at the front to augment Trini. While we're our new registration system, and we've evolved that, and now are getting a lot more online registrations, which is terrific. People still want someone to come in and have a chat with, and Trini and Anna are the face of that community center when you walk in, always greeting with a smile, and people love that, so they're always coming in. So that's why we really do need two receptionists, plus if Trini needs a break, Anna's there, and then Trini's off every Friday, so Anna works a full day on Friday. And then our recreation specialist, like Jason was talking about before, the receptionist up front at City Hall. A few of these staff members do work at City Hall as well as help coordinate several different programs. So it's worked out really well that when they're not doing, if it's a slow time up front and there's not a lot of work for them to do up front, they are working on several of the programs that they manage in our department while still being able to handle the phones and reception duties at City Hall. As you can see, we do have a full plate of activities and programs that the staff operate. We have a lot of facilities. We work hand in hand with Public Works to make sure the facilities are in the best shape that they can. We get to play on them, they get to fix them, but we definitely work together. We briefly, because I know you're all familiar with these, the community centers where our offices are, about 11,000 square feet, and home to a lot of programs. I'm sure that you've read through this, but go for the wrong one. We did a survey a while back, probably about 6 months ago, and so we've included some of the quotes of what some of the participants have had to say about our facilities and programs.
Corey, real quick, you also have the museum under your guys as well, too?
Correct.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah. I operate as the liaison for the museum. Any repairs and things that need to be made will go through Public Works, but I'm usually their contact. Okay. We'll handle them and try and disseminate all the information to Brett to get out to you as well. The youth center is about 3,300 square feet. It's a city-owned facility and programmed by the Los Alamitos Youth Center. The Youth Center, a private nonprofit agency. The city, per the agreement that expires in 2023, the city operates our senior lunch and bread program in the morning, about 8 to about 12:30. And after that, the other hours are given to the Youth Center for Youth Center programming. So their after-school program runs typically 2:30 once school lets out until 6 or 6:30, and then they do sometimes have programming in the evening or weekends. Our program runs the senior lunch and bread program. Prior to that, we do about 2,700 congregant lunches on site and about 2,100 home-delivered meals. We have some part-time rec leaders that are reimbursed through the bread program that the seniors run. Little Cottonwood Park, it's the largest city-owned open space. We have the 50th anniversary courtyard. We have some shelters, two shelters that we do rent out throughout the year with close to 7,000 people that utilize that. We have several of our programs that operate out of there, including Spring Carnival, Trunk or Treat, most recently Music and Movies. That was a big hit this last summer. We're looking forward to that again this summer. Our T-ball program, and then our summer park programs that gets about 1,800 participants over the course of the 10-week program, summer program. Laurel Park, was renovated back in 2012. We operate a tennis program, contracted tennis program. There's permanent restrooms, picnic tables, and home to two of our music and movie events. Orville Lewis Park, a little over an acre and a half. If you haven't been out there, a newly renovated playground is going in. I believe they put the base down today. We're doing a walkthrough with them on Thursday before they lay the pretty layer on top for the rubber. And pending everyone's availability, we're hoping early April to have the ribbon cutting ceremony for a brand new playground there. The previous playground was 24 years old, so it's the first playground that the city has replaced in 10 years, and we're replacing the oldest one in the city, so it's very, very exciting. The basketball court was renovated a few years ago. It's got a baseball backstop, picnic shelter, and barbecue, and was home to one music and movies event, which again was very successful and very well received, and we're looking forward to going back there again this summer. And our park programs with over 850 participants for the summer program there. The other parks, Coyote Creek, you're familiar with, Labradette, Roberts, Sir Optimus, Stansbury, and Stearns are kind of known as pocket parks, basically one parcel of land with typically a play structure of some sort, maybe a small shelter and a picnic area, some tables, a little bit of grass area, but very well received, very highly utilized by the locals that can walk to that community and to that local park. So. Not programmed facilities or activity out there, but very important nonetheless. You're familiar with our joint use facilities. We have a 5-year agreement with the school district, the 5-year extension, master joint use agreement, 4 Oak Middle School agreements, and 1 for McAuliffe, in addition to the Oak Middle School gymnasium. And our staff helps manage all of these, facilitates rentals of all of these, and coordinates very closely and works very closely with the school district for usage, not only by the school, but by the city programs as well as outside groups. So to go through our divisions a little bit, administration is expense heavy. This is where all of our full-time staff are coded. So obviously you can tell by the heavy expenses there. Not only are all the full-time staff, but the benefits and retirement. In addition to the staffing, we have our supply budget, training budget, memberships, the quarterly activities guide that gets produced and mailed is out of this division, technology for our department, as well as any equipment that's utilized for the entire department, like the copy machine and that sort of thing. The little bit of revenue that we do have is from Republic Services as a part of their contract to help to offset some of the costs for the activities guide, and they do get an advertising piece in our activities guide. Aquatics, the aquatics division, there we go, is we operate now, since MWR took over the pool, we operate just a swimming lesson program, which is group private and semi-private, a water aerobics program, a junior lifeguards program during the summertime, and then a master's swim program. The master's swim program operates about 15 to 20 adults. Junior lifeguards hovers around 30. Water aerobics is between 10 and 20, depending on the warmth of outside. And then our swimming lessons fluctuates a little bit, but over the past year, it's been about 1,000, 1,100 group lessons, plus the private and semi-private on top of that. The table off to the right kind of shows you where we have come since 2014-15, when the city managed the pool 100%. 15-16 is when it converted over, so there was a decrease, and then 16-17 and 17-18 is us renting the pool, paying for the lanes that we utilize, and managing our programs, and the base handles the management of the facility as well as the lifeguard component. Community services, this is where our seniors in our community center are housed. So we operate a senior lunch and bread program. This division also supports the Los Alamitos Senior Club, the nonprofit that the city started several years ago. The city runs a senior prom. We created that a couple years ago as an opportunity to create a new event, and it's been very highly received the last couple of years. We operate different classes, most of them at no cost to the seniors, and some at a very minimal cost. And then we do a lot of presentations and screenings for them as well. The community center, we have our facility rentals, our special events that people rent out the community center, utilize it for several different programs, as well as our picnic shelter. So any revenues and expenses go into this division. Our day camp, we run a 10-week summer program. The numbers have been increasing in participation the last few years, so we're hovering around the 60 to 70 kids a week. We do weekly excursions. Every week is themed differently. We do pool days. It's a very highly staffed program. We operate at 10-to-1 ratio. We want to make sure that the kids are obviously safe and following the rules and making sure that they're respectful. Very well supervised. The program runs all day extended care from 7 a.m. till 6 o'clock at night to accommodate work schedules. We also run a winter camp during winter break, and then a spring camp during the spring break. And as you can see, it's a very, very highly utilized program, and we're excited to offer that and change it up every year. Our playgrounds is where our park programs, again, very highly utilized. This is a drop-in program at Little Cottonwood and Orville Lewis. Last couple years, we really vamped this up, where we have a 10-week program. It's totally free. We don't know how many kids are going to show up each day. One day it could be 10, the next it could be 60. There are certain days when it's very, very highly attended. We offer 2 staff per site, activities and games. Kids can sign themselves in and out as long as they have that waiver signed. The parents understand that. We offer 6 free excursions, and then every Friday they have like a barbecue or some sort of food as well as activity. And last year, Generations Church provided all of that at no charge at Little Cottonwood Park. So we're hoping to continue that relationship this summer. Our sports division, we have adult sports that are run 3 seasons per year, and then our youth sports, very highly attended. Our youth basketball is definitely our largest, with 150 plus kids. Volleyball's in the fall, and then soccer, flag football, t-ball, track and field, mini superstars. A lot of our programs are not to compete with the local nonprofits. The AYSOs and the FNLs are so large and so well respected in this community and so involved. We try and augment them. So we'll try and hit the younger group up, or where there's a vacancy is when we'll try and step in and operate a program. And then the adult sports, adults need to play too. So we want to get them out and provide them a safe and fun environment, and we have the facilities to be able to do that. Special classes, we try and provide something for everybody. So we've got several contract instructors with hundreds of programs and camps. We want to make sure that, you know, if someone's got an interest, that we listen to it, find a teacher for them, and offer a class. It's a great opportunity for us. The last several years now, we partner with the other local communities, the small communities like us, even including Long Beach, Cypress, Seal Beach, La Palma, Buena Park, to share contract classes. It allows us to each reserve a certain number of spots in each class, and we're finding that we're canceling a lot less classes by doing that, and still being able to receive the revenue and provide that for all of our residents. So whether one or five of our residents want to register with us, and the same with Seal Beach and Cypress, we're still able to host a class with 6 or 8 or 10 kids or adults in that class. Also in special classes is our Ready, Set, Go preschool. Excited to say we are actually sold out right now. We're trying to see if we can get a wait list that's long enough that we can bring in an additional instructor. We operate 3 days a week for the 4 to 5 year olds and 2 days a week for the 3 year olds. Both are at capacity with our current staff to child ratio, I believe 16 in one class and 20 in the other. So we're going to try and see if we can accommodate more we're in the bungalow next door, to try and accommodate that, because there's obviously a need. Our LAVP, which I know you're very familiar with, is also housed in the special classes division. Our special events, Race on the Base, Spring Carnival, Weekend of Art, which we just had, 4th of July, Music and Movies, Trunk or Treat, and Winter Wonderland are all housed in this division. Very staff intensive, lots of expenses, but we're able to recoup a lot of the revenues, the majority of which is Race on the Base, and then second most is our 4th of July Fireworks Spectacular. The rest of them fluctuate in their revenues and expenses, and obviously as much as we can, we try and get as many sponsors as we can to help offset those costs. Obviously there's several needs and challenges going forward. Eventually we'd like to get back to full staffing. Recruitment and retention is a challenge, specifically in the aquatics division. It's really been a challenge since the loss of the pool, the management of the pool. Several of our staff have left to become employed by MWR, as well as other private entities in the local area or public entities in the local area. It's hard to retain them because of the lack of hours that we have by giving a staff member 2 hours or a day or something as low as that. It's a challenge to retain them when they can get 4 to 5 hours at another agency. Minimum wage increases, the sustainability of sponsorships. Our staff works diligently time and time again, event after event and program after program, to try and find other people's money by utilizing their kind of our niches, rather than just getting them to donate to a nonprofit. We work with each business individually to try and help them use their marketing dollars. So if a business wants to market to a certain age group, that's where we want them to spend our money, rather than paying for a gigantic billboard somewhere. We hope that they'll spend it with us, and we can do it kind of at a grassroots level, and we've been very successful at that. Our facilities are getting a little old, we're putting them together as much as we can. Obviously we would love to have a needs assessment, and our events continue to grow. Even if we stop marketing them, they continue to grow and expand. Word of mouth is obviously our best way of getting word out, and people continue to do that. Then like I alluded to earlier, the aquatics uncertainty. Again, based on the staffing levels, it's a challenge to retain the staff. It's a challenge to recruit staff, knowing that they're not going to get a ton of hours, there's a lot of local competition. So we have seen our numbers drop significantly in the last year and a half or so, year and a half. We just want to be able to make sure that if we are going to be able to operate, if we're going to continue to operate a program, that we're able to do so. And if not, if that's the path that we're going down, that we can, you know, let the public know and be able to refer them elsewhere if that's where we need to go. So, and as you know, one of our mottos is parks make life better, and we believe that truly in Los Alamitos. And that's the end of my presentation. If you guys have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Do we have any questions, Mark?
Yeah, I have a quick one. Corey, thank you for the presentation. But when you're sharing an instructor with another city, are your fees comparable?
Yes.
Okay. So, because it wouldn't do good to
correct
have one city charge a different price.
Correct.
Okay.
Yep.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Josh, do you have anything?
We on the Budget Standing Committee is kind of review of what we had as well. So it's been informative. It's a lot of hard work you guys put in this as well. So I think the committee is looking at a holistic approach on our budget to make sure that we're not running it. We're basically balancing our budget. So,
Richard.
I'm on the committee too.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
Thank you. You know, I think it's important for the community gets to see where their money goes and what we all do. Thank you.
Yeah, I have a couple comments. Can we go up in the presentation to show the admin costs in total? So I met with staff earlier and went through all these. And, you know, the thing that I would say is that we've done a really good job of basically treating each of these different departments as profit centers. The only challenge is administration is by itself, as you can see, it's a cost center. So about $700,000 difference. And if you were to see it, the total budget for Parks and Rec is about 1.7, which isn't on this slide, but versus the revenue that we get of about $1 million. So, you know, we've always talked about for the last 10 or 11 years that Parks and Recreation is a community service that's a balanced quality of life versus, you know, the performance and the reward of financial. As we get into harder times coming up, I mean, this is just one part of our entire budget problem that we have, where we're going to talk about pensions. Today we talked about Jason's group, admin, and we talked about Corey. And if you look at it, you know, admin makes everything happen, and Parks and Rec is at about a 67% of revenue when they're going in. And the only reason I'm bringing this out is I think Corey has done an unbelievable job. I think this is today going through this with him, unbelievable in the level of detail. And if you compare this to other cities, I think Corey, we were talking about this, 60 to 70% is usually it's pretty good for a city to recover that much cost. What were you saying were the average costs out there?
Yeah, I did some. The group that did the fee study for us is called MBS, and they do this type of thing, this type of study across up and down the state. And they had indicated that the average cost recovery in a recreation department is usually around 50%. Mm-hmm. So that means they bring in 50% of revenue to cover, you know, cover half the cost. In our situation, it's if we eliminate the two positions, which we're proposing, the two full-time, the cost recovery would be about 64%, and that's incredible. It's above the average, and I think it reflects, you know, recreation's ability to do a lot with, you know, limited resources. I want to point out that the $917,000 number reflects a breakout. So there's, you've got salary and benefit costs, that's $839,000. And then you've got, you know, the other non-personnel, so like you've got, you know, the $78,000. So it's broken down, the recreation brochure, technology costs and that sort of thing. In that salary and benefit number of $839,000, there's $166,000 of pension costs. And that's across the board citywide. If you remember from last month, the city's pension cost annually in 17-18 is $1.5 million. So that cost allocated to recreation's department is $166,000. And so that's reflected in the $917,000 number.
Yeah, so kind of other things in there. You know, if you look at this, it's hard sometimes to put together the entire picture because we get four or five sessions to cover different parts of the city. But, you know, when we start looking for that final $200,000 to $500,000 to cover a differential, you know, Jason's talked about taking it out of the reserves, and, you know, we may have to do that. But you can't keep doing that. You can't sustain that every year, and we've really got a budget problem. The other part I would talk about is if you go down to where the youth center fits into the plan. You know, Councilmember Kusumoto, a couple times when we were having our goals and workshops, was really kind of attacking the, you know, what are we going to do for more structural revenue? And, you know, through that discussion, not directly from him, but, you know, this council had talked about assessment districts and all these different ways of going about trying to recover, including utility users tax. We've watched the cities around us actually add a 1% sales tax increase, which is absolutely nothing that we want. But, you know, you've got to look at the bigger picture and say, are we fully utilizing all of our assets? So the youth center is 3,300 square foot facility. The contract is up in 6 years. There's no amount that's paid, and I'm not pushing that we should be charging the youth center. But there's increments to start attacking is that pretty soon at some point with all these problems we have and we have to raise structural revenue, we would need to ask ourselves, are we utilizing every asset? And when I look at the youth center, I think at a minimum utilities or potentially using the excess capacity of a youth center when it's not used every night or on the weekends, who uses the facility? If you look at how much time that we have in capacity in our community center, would we be able to utilize excess capacity when this place is shut and closed? So I don't know, it's something I'd like to look at over the next year or two is, you know, how do we work with the youth center to try to find out that excess capacity and realize, because I got to tell you, when it comes to solutions for our structural problem that we have and it's coming up on a deficit, you know, first for me would be utilized assets within the city. Last would be a sales tax increase. Somewhere in between would be utility users tax, and somewhere in between there would be an assessment district. So I think we need to kind of think about it, because I see something coming up on the agenda in the next couple of months where we're going to look at fees, fee studies, and those get retranslated in the community as being tax hikes. Believe me, I know for a fact, you know, I was the guy that voted on that and then it was persecuted after. But I think really, again, this part, we need to look at the youth center, work with Lena and the group over there, and figure out longer term, we're not trying to get aggressive at all, but I mean, we've got to utilize our assets and try to find a structural way to find revenue here before we start taxing our own specific residents to be able to go. Those are the only comments that I had. And again, I wanted to thank staff for going through that with me today. Thank you.
I just had real quick, Jason, can you go to slide 17, the aquatics program? So Corey, you were mentioning the challenges that you have just trying to retain staff, trying to even hire staff, and looking at 16-17 versus 17-18, you know, the revenues are staying the same, the expenses are going up, and that expense number does not include any of your time, Ron's time, anybody else's time. So I would be safe to assume that we're actually this year going to be operating as a deficit. In soft costs.
Correct. So these are all, like all the numbers in the individual divisions, are all direct expenditures. So for, since even, I believe, 13-14, when I became the director, the full-time support in the aquatics division was eliminated. That recreation supervisor was eliminated, and I retained management of the pool. So no other full-time staff. I'm the only one that manages the pool directly with full-time staff. So that would be really the only overhead, and then a little bit of the secretaries to handle the registration component.
And I think the reason for my comment is just for my colleagues here, I think we just need to come to a point where are we going to grow this program? Is it even possible for us to grow this program? I think we know the answer to that. And then when do we sit back and look at that and saying that's no longer a viable program? We just need to be out of aquatics and just cut our losses and go. And I don't know if it's this year or next year, but I think we need to decide, because, you know, all this work and the challenges that you're hitting to have a net income of $5,000, you know, when is it no longer worth our time? And we have so many other things that we can do so much better with the resources and that money that we could, you know, take programs that we can grow and we can get better at, as opposed to something that we have no control over, really. We don't own the pool. We don't manage the pool. We just rent the pool. So when are we going to make that decision or even have the discussion on where are we in the aquatics business?
And actually, in terms of the discussion probably is now, but at least in terms of where we are with the hiring freeze and with the budget situation, we haven't been filling the part-time aquatics positions, and we weren't planning on filling those part-time aquatics positions. It's something that we, you know, would like to discuss with the council, because as we do that, it basically, we wouldn't advertise those positions in the brochure, and it basically takes that function of swim safety out of the equation. We could, and Corey's talked about creative ways of looking at working with others that can provide that function, and we could try to offer classes in that and evaluate that over time. But right now, because of the hiring freeze, we're not filling those positions. So we wanted to bring that to the council's attention just to make you aware of that. It's something we could still, you know, if we're doing it now, it in effect, it eliminates that function in the city. If we phase it over time and look at summer and then taking it out of the equation, that's another thing that we can do. But we want to make you aware of that right now.
When is the deadline for the summer brochure? Or is it already passed?
It's within the next 2 weeks.
So we need to make a decision for this year now, or we just know that this is what we're going into it for the next year and have a more heated discussion on 18-19? Any comments, discussion?
Well, I guess relative to the service that you're providing, and, you know, is it, I'll say, cost effective at the level you provided versus, they say, a private swim school or private instructors? And then who will be impacted the most? I remember, you know, my kids, they went through the swim program through the city when you were using the pool at the high school. And that was like, hurry up, line up at 4 a.m. to get in line to be up there first. So there's a lot of demand out there, I believe, still in the community. But how will they be able to fulfill that?
So, you know, like you said, it's, you know, it's really a challenge for me as a recreation professional to eliminate a program, especially a safety program. We used to offer 1,500 to 2,000 lessons a year. We saw a decrease leading up to when the city was no longer going to manage the pool because of the uncertainty. And then we've seen a decrease with the ramping up of the private swim schools in this community, as well as, again, the lack of flexibility that we have currently with the current management of, you know, we kind of pay for play is we're limited on our number of days and times and ability to be able to get in the water, coupled with the challenge of hiring and retaining staff. I think MWR took about five of our staff members, I don't want to say took, about five of our traditional staff members went over to MWR, a couple went to private swim schools, and a couple actually went over to Garden Grove to the new Great Wolf. So it's hard to compete with a 6-hour day or a 5-hour day when I've got a 2-hour, when I'm giving them a 2-hour day. It's really, really difficult to, you know, as you have kids or friends that are in college to manage their schedules and high school after school programs. It's just a challenge to find staff. As far as to your question about the finding it elsewhere, obviously the people that have left us have found it elsewhere. We do offer a much lower cost than the private entity, but we're also kind of in the higher cost for public entities. If you look at some of the surrounding cities, they do charge less. Some limit it strictly to residents only, so that might be a bit of a challenge. My hope is that if this program were eliminated, due to the timing, it'd be a challenge in the beginning, but maybe in the fall or next year, we definitely would try and look to partner, like our contract classes, with a private entity or with an individual or different individuals to be able to offer some sort of water safety swim lesson program just to be able to offer that to our residents. Again, we don't know what the price point would be or where it would be, whether it be back at the base or whether it be at a private swim school or elsewhere. But, you know, my goal would be to bring some sort of aquatic program back as a contract class if the city's program is eliminated.
Thank you.
So just an answer, a question to my colleagues, is this something that just be for timing that we keep the aquatics program for this year, knowing that it's going to be pretty much a break even, and then work on it next year to kind of phase it out, work with some contract classes, and then move forward from 18-19?
Yeah, I think 2 weeks is probably a little too soon for the summer. I'd like to see Lycios through the summer in that sense, but what Corey hit on it was a nail on the head. You know, this is kind of a death spiral. If we can't attract the talent for staff to have the classes, it's not going to retain the students, and then it's only going to exacerbate itself once we don't have the students or cancellations of class.
Right.
So I'd hope like to revisit this sometime, you know, within the next few months so that we can look to a fall to make a decision and give ourselves enough time to notify instructors, notify students, and look to alternative options that we could see.
Can I ask
I'm sorry if I can, I'm just weighing on the question if I can. I think that, 2 weeks is a little too soon. And I really, you know, while it's important for staff and understand that part of it, it's really the public and the safety aspect of that. So I think we need to provide that for, you know, those that cannot go to the private school or, you know, the other entities, or the base may not have the schedule for them. So if there's anything we can do, and this is for public safety, I think we have to do it. And then look at some graceful way to perhaps transition to something else. And I'll speak with you offline. But thank you.
What condition is the pool? I mean, it's been a year since we've been maintaining it. What's the experience for the community?
To the public eye, probably not much. They've replaced a couple of the, at least to my knowledge, they've replaced a couple of the eyewash stations, which again, unless the public gets chlorine or something like that, which they shouldn't be in that area anyway. They replaced the heater the day before the race this year. But other than that, the deck hasn't changed. The pool condition itself hasn't changed. The lights haven't been upgraded. The conditions of the pool. We haven't been notified of anything. Our lease agreement with MWR was up last August. We're kind of month to month with them at this point. They did indicate in September that the rates would likely go up. In December, they said, well, we're just going to leave it for right now. So we're kind of operating on a month-to-month basis. I send them a schedule. As long as it doesn't change drastically, we're kind of allotted our time. I know if we need more or less, I kind of negotiate with the other users before approaching MWR. But to the public, not really much has changed on the deck from their standpoint or from their visual.
Okay. Is Water Polo still call that their home?
To my knowledge, they're not in right now. Typically, they come back around May after the season. So my understanding is they will be returning. But again, I can't guarantee that. I have heard through the grapevine that Greta Anderson is no longer utilizing the facility, though. Other than that, I believe the other groups are, and I think even another high school water polo club has joined in to utilize it.
Cool. Thank you.
And Warren, I do agree with you. I just wanted to bring that up so we can stick it on an agenda in the next few months to have more of a detailed discussion. Yep. And not, I don't want to rush anything, but it needed to be brought up so we can address it and give you guys some sort of direction.
We appreciate that direction for now. So we will continue through the summer. We'll continue to hire the part-time aquatic staff, and we'll get it into the brochure, and then we'll bring it back after the summer to the council, let you know where we stand, give you an update, and get additional direction at that.
Yeah, and I would say even before summer, because we need to make some decision for the fall programs.
Yes.
So.
Yes, okay. Before the fall. Yep. Deadline.
Anything else? All right.
Would it be something that you'd like us to bring forth to the commission to get their buy-in prior to bring it to the council? Would you rather a discussion with the council of it first?
So one of the points I'd probably make with the city council is empowering our commissions. Yeah. And this is something I would put on their agenda for the next available commission meeting so that we have a plan, at least the following one. But that's at least something that outlines one strategic goals for the pool, and then an outline of just what the current reality is. And then also what losses to the community that we would suffer if we cancel the programs, what current benefits now are being outlined, and then at what point does it become unsustainable to subsidize, in effect, allow us to do it, the programs.
Yeah, that's a great idea. All right, so we're going to adjourn this special meeting into the regular 4 minutes ago.
Thank you for all your feedback. Appreciate it.
Thank you.